was beautiful. And you're about to hear a whole lot more of beautiful things, but it's all about Jesus. I think every time any church gathers, they ought to make a big deal about the Lord Jesus Christ. There is nobody else and nothing else. So why don't you make a big deal right now? Thank you, Jesus. Stand with me, please. Stretch a little bit. And I know you've probably already talked to the people beside you, and you've determined now if you like them or not. If you're saved, let me tell you this. Three of the best, greatest words you will ever utter are, I am forgiven. Are you glad that the blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed you from all unrighteousness and you have been forgiven of all your trespasses yesterday, today, and forever? Well, I say it every time we gather at Christmas or Resurrection Sunday. This church has been doing this a lot of times, a lot of years. 47 years we've been practicing and singing and blessing the people and glorifying the Lord. So here we are again tonight. This is 2024. I thought Jesus would have come by now. I wanted him to come this week. I want him to come today. I pray he comes before tomorrow. We're supposed to do communion tomorrow, but I would love to do it with him in that holy place called heaven, wouldn't you? So, Father, we thank you tonight. We're a grateful people. We're the most blessed people who have ever walked on this planet. And besides all of the material blessings, it's your grace and your mercy that you've poured upon us. We walk in the gifts of God. So I pray now, Lord, as we listen and sing and praise, as they play and perform, may the name of Jesus be magnified and lifted ever so high tonight. And the whole church said amen. You may be seated. And would you give the singers and musicians a wonderful round of applause as they present Forgiven.
Son of God. It began just as the prophet Isaiah had written. Look, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, and he will prepare your way. He is a voice shouting in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord's coming. Clear the road for him.
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the beautiful message of the resurrection. Where would we be today without it? We would be the most hopeless of creatures. We were separated from you by our own rebellion, but nothing would keep you from reaching out, from coming down to earth, taking on our flesh, and from carrying our sin to the cross. Just as surely as we celebrate the power of the resurrection, we also reflect on the cross and we share in the suffering. When Jesus died, he died for my sins and he died for your sins. His wounds were my wounds. His pain was my pain. Oh, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering.
Forgive them, I heard you faintly say. Still in my heart I feel so guilty. I know the truth is the debt was mine to pay. How could it be right that it happened this way? A fallen and sinful life I was leading. Now why is your body torn and bleeding? It should have been my hands where the nails were. It should have been. It should have been my feet where the nails were. It should have been. It should have been my side that was open, my heart that was broken. It should have been my hands. never seen the light. I wouldn't long for the sunlight if it wasn't for the night. If there hadn't been a father who made a way where there was none, I'd still be an orphan if it wasn't for his son. If there hadn't been a grave, if there hadn't been a cross, my heart would still be buried and my soul would still be lost. If there hadn't been a Savior who died to make a way, oh, I'd still be a dead man if there hadn't been a grave. If I didn't know my sin, if there hadn't been forgiveness that covered all my shame, oh, I'd still be a debtor if you didn't take my place. If there hadn't been a grave, if there hadn't been a cross, my heart would still be buried and my soul would still be lost. If there hadn't
with Jesus. Yeah, moved out of my parents' house and was selling drugs and doing drugs and drinking. And I was saving for an adventure with my friends to go on a bus trip. We were buying a 1984 school bus, and we're gonna travel the country and get our education that way. During that time, we were, you know, We were stealing copper, and we stole all of our food. And I felt the spirit work on me even in that time and say that you can't do this. We agreed to not steal anymore for the bus trip. That next week, there was one of us who was arrested and went to prison for 7 years for stealing a car that week. And that was kind of a final confirmation for that chapter crossroad. God has showed up in my life at every crossroad, and I have not done it perfect. I mess up all the time and go my own way. This most recent chapter of life, it was probably 7 years before I even said a prayer. I was doing pretty good by the world standards, was drinking, but it was manageable, and was doing well in business, and was in a committed relationship with a woman that I thought I loved, and she did not love Jesus at all. And I remember being outside in the garden and feeling the presence of the Lord. I spoke to God in 7 years, and I asked God to either give me the confidence to move forward in this relationship or remove this woman from my life. A couple weeks later, she broke up with me. It was a very painful process, having her removed from my life. And the wild thing is, I didn't even remember praying that prayer. It wasn't until my brother invited me back to Central Church, and I couldn't even tell you what pastor was preaching on, but it clicked. I remembered praying that prayer and God telling me, you asked for this. You wanted this to be a part of the greatest love story ever told between a living God and a human being. And I'm grateful to God for that opportunity.
Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for Well, there was a big portion of my life that I didn't really know where the rage was coming from. We went to church every time the door was open. My mom could fly into a fit of rage and beat the living daylights out of me and tell me that she was doing it because she loved me. And in the next breath, she would say, "You'll never amount to anything." This left me with a very distorted view about God. I was afraid of her wrath. My teenage years, I felt like a misfit. My marriage was a mockery to God. I had married the familiar pattern that I had grown up with, abuse and control. I wanted the sidewalk to open up and swallow me. I was a very broken human being. But somehow or another, I know it was God, brought me to Central Church of God 23 years ago. And I learned the most important lesson of my life was that God loved me unconditionally. I didn't have to be good enough. I didn't have to do a whole lot of works, or I could do nothing at all. In 2003, Central had a home for women. It was a shelter to begin the healing process. I got godly counsel and a great support system. I learned how to apply God's word to everyday living. I learned that I'm only responsible for my words and my actions. I started learning healthy patterns, replacing the lies and misconceptions and the half-truths with the truth of God's word. I had the dream as a child to become an artist. It took 10 years to finish school, but I did it. I have forgiven my mom because I know she did the very best she knew how to do with what she had to work with. Thank God for forgiveness.
Calls me his own. Beautiful Savior.
that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Soviet Russia, in Siberia. At home, I was one kid, okay? And then when I came, went on the street, I was another kid. I began to swear and cuss and lie and cheat. And the most of all, I had this desire to have something that doesn't belong to me. I began to steal. And my parents, they didn't know what to do with me. It was so bad. It was a winter break, and my grandma came to me. She said, listen, do you want to live with us for a couple of weeks while you have winter break? Then one evening, very freezing evening in Siberia, they decided to go to church, and they said, do you want to go with us? That's where I heard the good news. Preacher said, God loves you. You just have to repent your sins. You have to come to him and he'll forgive you. I began to cry to God. I don't remember what I prayed. You know, I just said, forgive me, I'm sorry, forgive me. And I got up from those knees and I felt relief. I felt such a joy. I was going one direction. And when I got saved, I went completely different direction. God forgive me my sins. Yeah, maybe I did some mistake, but I knew I have hope. Forgiving means to have a hope in him. When I was baptized during summertime and came back to school in September, our principal, they called me to the office. And I came without tie. You know, all in Kamenev's regime, all kids, they had a tie, like a red pioneer's tie. They said, why you don't wear a tie? I said, you know, I'm a Christian now, going to church. I'm not gonna wear a tie anymore. And I said, I cannot do that. I cannot serve two masters. And they're like, oh my goodness. They brainwashed him during the summertime. I gave my heart to him and he blessed me. He opened the doors for us to preach the gospel in post-Soviet. And I found great wife. She's a Christian. He blessed us with beautiful kids, beautiful home, and we were so blessed. Yes, I experienced some persecution for my faith. My grandpa was taken to prison. My mom told me a story when she was a little girl. She was sitting on his lap, and he said, listen, there's a country, like United States of America, where people go to church free. No one tell them nothing. They can go to church free. But just because he preached the gospel, because he was a Christian, he was just living life, you know. He shared the gospel, he had Bible. And I still have that Bible. It was in front of the door on a table. And police came in. They looked, searched all over the house. They looked all over. They couldn't find it. That was a miracle, you know. And they grabbed him, and he was in jail for a while. They forbid him to preach. They said, if you preach again, you go to jail for a long time, just because they believe in God. I don't know how people can live without Christ, you know, just have family or have business or have anything without faith. I can't say that I found Christ. He definitely found me, because I was so lost. I didn't know my way, but he found me. And I can tell you, in my life, God is more than alive. He's faithful.
I gave my life to save. Hello, my name is Leah Pons, and we artists here came so we could just come and paint just a portion of our testimony. And my testimony is simple. Before the Lord, I didn't have confidence. I was fearful, I was weak, I was insecure, and I prayed for those insecurities to go away every day. And one day I realized, I woke up and I realized I didn't have insecurities anymore because God, I was able to find my identity in God. And I was able to mount up with wings as eagles and fly in His confidence.
I always thought heaven was like on a scale, that if I did more good works than sin, God would let me in. But then someone shared with me, it's for by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. My name is Lawrence. I received Jesus as my personal Savior, and now I'm kept by the power of God.
I'm Archie. This is from Psalms 1. I say the word of God whenever I walk through the parking lots or up the stairs. I shall be like a tree planted by rivers of waters, whose leaves shall not wither. That means my body will be healthy. I shall bear fruit in my season, which means I will have emotional intelligence, and whatever I do shall prosper. Amen.
Amen.
My name is Karen, and I was brought up going to church, but I never heard that you had to be born again. And I was living in darkness, and I was bound by chains of addiction and just so many different things that you don't want to hear. And it wasn't until I was 25 years old that I knelt at the cross and I surrendered my life to Christ. And when I did that, those chains were broken, those chains of darkness, and I've been living for Him ever since.
Amen.
Savior.
across the cross, the old rugged cross. It was there where my Savior would hang. Thank you, Jesus. The cross, the cross, the old rugged cross. It was there all my sins were washed away.
There was a rumbling, a groaning, and a battle that was being won. As creation moaned for the resurrecting power to take the battle, death defeated, and life wins.
Thank you. I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll? But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll and look inside. Then one of the elders said to me, Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals. Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God men from every tribe and language and nation and people. And you have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God. And they will reign on the earth. Then I looked and I heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000 times 10,000. They were encircling the throne and the four living creatures and the elders. And in a loud voice they sang, Worthy, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and on the sea and all that is in them saying, To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever.
to gather before you. And he is a one with me to hear of the Lamb who was crucified, who descended to hell, yet was raised up to reign at the Father's side. And the angels will cry,
say we're there.
Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I join Pastor Livingston in thanking all of you for being here. Lots of Central folks. I see guests as well. But thanks for sharing this evening with us. And what a wonderful time we've had, right? And I know you want to join me in thanking these talented folks on stage. Amen. And there's a lot of equally talented folks that you cannot see behind soundboards and cameras and all in the back, so thank them. And I want to take just a moment, because Pastor said at the beginning, the reason we're here tonight is to thank Jesus. Oh, how we thank Him for the cross. We thank Him for His blood. We thank Him for the empty tomb. We thank him for the fact that because he's alive, we can live also. Aren't you thankful to be forgiven? Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the Lord. I tell you, forgiveness is a great thing. And there's been a lot of singing, a lot of practicing that's gone on getting ready for tonight. But I tell you, there's been a lot of prayer also. And I know a lot of you, and I know you love the Lord, and you have celebrated tonight because you have been forgiven. But while we've been here to worship the Lord, to lift up his name, our hope is that just one person maybe. I know there's somebody here that hasn't had that experience, maybe somebody watching online. And forgiveness from God means that our sins are completely gone. They are washed away. They are erased. They are no more. Jesus did for us what we could never do for ourselves. Oh, we had a great debt, and the debt was called sin. In fact, when you read about forgiveness in Scripture, in every verse, it's almost paired up with sin. A pastor preached it a few weeks ago. You can't appreciate the good news till you know the bad news. And the bad news is every one of us have fallen short of the glory of God. We're all sinners. But the good news is that Jesus said, whoever comes to him, he will in no wise cast out. I also read in the Word of God, if we confess those sins, he's faithful and he is just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Oh, the gospel has been preached tonight in song, and you've heard some powerful, beautiful voices. But I pray tonight you've heard the voice of God saying that I love you. Draw near to me, and I will draw near to you. I love the scripture in Colossians that says he has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, forgiveness of sins. So if you've not had that experience tonight, all you have to do, it's not physically, but we're kneeling at the cross. That's where it all happened. In fact, when Jesus said, it is finished, that word was really like a debt. We talked about the debt of sin. Imagine the biggest debt you have now or you've ever had, and immediately some benefactor paid it off. It's gone. So when Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, what he was saying is paid in full by the blood of Jesus Christ. Praise the Lord. So I believe they're going to do one more song, but I would love to pray with you. And if that is you tonight, if your heart is heavy, there is hope. His name is Jesus Christ. He loves you. He knows what you're going through even tonight. He walked this earth just like you do, and he loves you. God so loved the world, he gave his only Son that whoever believes on him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. That's what this season is about. That is Resurrection Sunday. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we say thank you. And oh, there are not enough songs or music scores written to articulate our gratitude to you. And Lord, we will spend eternity gathered around that throne that Gabby quoted about, singing, holy, holy, worthy is the Lamb. Lord, that you are great and greatly to be praised. So we thank you for so great a gift. Oh, Lord, the gift of salvation, the gift of life in Jesus Christ, the eternal gift of your love. So thank you for these musicians. Thank you for this evening. Thank you for the opportunity one more time to remember the greatest story ever told, the love of God brought to this earth. And Lord, for that one who's here tonight, who is not walking in forgiveness, may they call upon you tonight and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Forgive me of my sins. And that moment, they will experience the greatest miracle they've ever experienced in their life. So thank you, God, for this evening. Thank you for your grace. We worship you, we praise you, and we adore you, and we thank you for forgiveness. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let's enjoy this last song together.
on enough colors to paint the whole picture. Not enough words to ever say what I found. Wonderful and